Okay, guys, today on Nomadic Delights, my guest is Mubarik Ibrahim. He is an experienced student recruitment officer with an exceptional history of working in the higher education industry. Welcome to Nomadic Delights, Mubarik, and thank you for joining me today.
Hey, I'm glad to be here.
Sweet. Well, first of all, I'd like to start off by asking you to introduce yourself to my listeners. If you can please start off by telling us a bit about yourself. I mean, first of all, let me start off with the word Mubsy. I saw that when I checked you out on LinkedIn. What's going on over there?
I mean, it's just something that I've been called by friends and growing up in school and things like that from about 14 years old. So yeah, it's been around longer than most people have been alive, you know. So it's just been one of those things that just continued and just kind of it's just been easy. But yeah, Mubarik is fine. I'm from London. How old am I? I'm not 29. I'm getting older. I still feel quite young. But you know, I spoke to my cousin the other day, and she said, we're on FaceTime, and she said, "Oh, I swear you've been 20 for about 15 years now. You never age." So alhamdulillah, I'm blessed. I'm gonna keep that as my motivation. You know. I see videos of Pharrell Williams on YouTube. This guy's going on about 45, 50 now. He's still looking like he's 17. So, inshallah, that's goals right there.
Well, I ain't gonna lie. When I checked out on your LinkedIn profile, I saw the afro in full effect. So let's just say, man, you're still a baby faced compared to a lot of people out there.
I know, but. but that picture itself is a funny little story as well. This random person, photographer. I'll explain my job. There's a reason why I was in Liverpool where that photo was taken.
Okay.
And I was walking along Albert Docks, you know, just taking it in. I've never been to Liverpool at that point.
Uh-huh.
And this guy stops me and goes, "Can I ask you a couple of questions?" And I'm like, yeah, go ahead. He's like, "So I'm a photographer. I run this blog and..." He's like, "I like a style. Can I like take a few pictures?" And I was like, I mean, I was like, why not? Like,
no stranger alert, nothing. You just, go for it. Yeah.
Yeah, mate, go for it. It's happened loads of times before. This other guy, he's a US blogger, and he's, his Instagram is sort of like my main narrative. He's this African guy. Mm-hmm. Who lives out in New York, and he just takes pictures of people who've got afro hair and everything. Wow. Like that. So he's very much empowering people's natural hair and all that sort of stuff. And yeah, he stopped me in the middle of Heathrow. which is quite funny. So I don't know. Some people will probably put like model in their bios and all that kind of stuff, but
yeah.
It's just people taking photos at the end of the day.
I didn't actually realize. So you also twice, so once in Liverpool, which I know you're going to finish up, but again in Heathrow, man, this afro is really, you know, like your calling card, man.
it is a signature. So like for my job, I'm a student recruitment officer and widening participation officer.
Oh yeah, that's a bit of a mouthful there. That's a big job title right there.
Honestly, it's so many different job titles I've had over the years, doing exactly the same thing. You know, there's no difference. Yeah. It's just a change in name. But a lot of that is you know, down to me going into different schools, colleges, up and down the country, just talking to students about higher education and just kind of giving them as much information, the best information, advice and guidance
right
to go on in their careers. And it's funny, the amount of kids, when I walk into their school, they're kind of immediately, they just stop and stare and they're just like taken in by the afro. And then they'll come to like one of my open events, like an open day, and they'll recognize me straight away. And they're like, "Oh yeah, you came into my school."
Nice.
I kind of like, I have to kind of pay that. Yeah, I remember you. Yeah. No, I don't. They only remember me because of my afro, but at the same time, it's just nice seeing their reaction to seeing someone who they've spoken to and they've been around. But it's a funny little job. It took me to Liverpool because I was doing the recruitment cycle. So UCAS, if you're familiar with the UK application system,
right,
and the search tool that also has that has all the different courses, they've got like a events wing, and they run all these events up and down the country, and I picked to go to Liverpool.
Okay.
Like when it comes to picking events, with like the teams at my old university were about four or five of us, and we'd sit down and we'd divvy out who gets where.
Yeah.
And obviously when I was there for 6 years, 7 years, and I'd always pick the ones that I wanted to pick.
It was
almost like negotiating. Look, I'll do this, this, and this.
Yeah.
Which are my favorite ones, and then you guys can just pick any of the others. I don't really care.
top dog choices there.
Hey, look, when you've been there for 7 years, you kind of get to do things, you know, that maybe a first year or a newbie won't be able to do. Correct. And that's not saying people should just, you know, throw their weight about.
Yeah.
But you've got to earn that. I think that's the most important thing in a workplace. You've got to earn the trust of your seniors.
Well, come to that point. So you went to Liverpool, and this guy stops you whilst you're walking at Albert Docks. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then he goes, "Can I just take a photo of you?"
Yeah. I don't know. I really don't know how else to explain that story. It was completely random. Like, and like, the thing is that he was kind of looking at me for a long time.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, what's this guy looking at? You know?
Yeah.
And it wasn't until we got closer to him that he, you know, came up, introduced himself, and yeah, we just wanted to take photos. He took a couple, sent me the high quality ones.
Yep.
And stuck them on the blog. I can't for the dear life of me remember where that blog is, but I've got the photos.
Ah, well, you know what? Honestly, it is a great photo, and it's kind of good you mentioned, because you gave us a quick intro about the student recruitment world, because actually today's podcast is about the higher education industry, you know, specifically within the university context. Yeah. But you've gave a quick intro, but I want to understand, what is a student recruitment officer and what led you to enter this world?
Yeah. So I touched upon it a little bit, but basically what the role entails is talking to students, giving them the best information, advice and guidance, and making sure that they know the steps that they need to then progress in whatever field that they want to progress in.
Right.
Nowadays it's if you don't want to go to university, it's like, right, okay, what skills and what kind of extra qualifications may you need to get into your chosen field.
Mm-hmm.
And it's sometimes helping kids with personal statements for UCAS, or writing, you know, selling themselves. Sometimes some student recruitment officers would do kind of interview skills,
mm-hmm.
both for a course and just kind of preparing people for interview skills. Cause you never, when you're about 15, 16, you never really know what an interview's like.
Correct.
At that age. Mm-hmm. So it's always good to kind of prepare people. And it's looking at life after school, after you've left sixth form or college. What is it that you're going to do? Are you going to go to uni? Are you going to go do an apprenticeship? What is it that you're going to go do? And we do make sure that we give the best advice. We don't want to send someone down the wrong path, on the path that they don't want to go down. Mm. And they realize 3-4 years down the line, actually, this isn't something that I want to do.
Right.
So we do try and work with students. We also work with schools, mm-hmm. and see how we can help them with their curriculum, because universities have got experts in their field. And now if a school want someone who is a sports scientist or a physiotherapist to come in and just kind of talk about the human body, then we've got that expertise. So we try and help schools progress in with their pupils learning and their kind of extracurricular activities.
Mm-hmm.
And then I've also got the widening participation angle, which is, it's very different to that. I mean, it's still giving the same information, advice and guidance, but more so working with students from disadvantaged backgrounds and those who are underrepresented at university. Right. And we try and make our universities look like our diverse societies. Yeah. I mean, society is very diverse, but our universities are very white-centric, if I can say that. Mm-hmm. So we're just trying to encourage people from those underrepresented backgrounds who may feel that they don't want to go to university because university is not for them, or they can't afford to go to university, and just trying to break down all the myths about it and actually saying, you know, if you go to university, you can better yourself and develop new career, new skills, sorry. But at the same time, one thing we definitely don't want to do is send someone off to university, they come out and they're back into that kind of mindset of, right, you know, you're back in ends is what I'm going to say.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah,
when you're back on the block and you're around people who may not have gone to university, and that's absolutely fine.
Yeah.
But sometimes, you know, we all know that your friendship groups really do affect your path. And a lot of people do succumb to peer pressure. So it's not saying that, you know, you go to uni, you come out, you're going to be doing exactly the same thing that you were doing when you were 16. But
yeah,
we're just trying to help and, you know, develop your career. Really.
So at what stage are you coming? Are you coming when people are starting their GCSE or when they're finishing? At what point are you entering from a high school perspective?
Yeah, I mean, it's gone back lower. I mean, it's
wow.
Some universities, and I know myself, I've worked with pupils in year two.
Seriously?
And it's all about kind of drip feeding them small bits of information,
yeah,
and normalizing the idea of further education and higher education.
Okay.
Because
okay,
if we try and hit them when they're 15, 16,
yeah,
that's almost too late. They've already developed a sense of what they want to do.
Correct.
So if we can work with the younger students, and I remember working at my first university, the one that I'm sure you're going to ask me about in a second.
Yeah.
We worked with pupils in year five, and I remember an academic coming up to me saying, why do we have young kids? You know, it's a little bit too early to for them to think about university. And I'm like, yeah, it's early for them to think about university. But the activities that I did with them was very much like draw your best university, you know, think of all these crazy ideas.
Mm.
And it's interesting what these students think about university is, sorry.
Yeah.
So I remember one kid drew, he was into his gaming, and yeah, he drew a university on the beach, and it had like PlayStation sections, it had Xbox sections, and he's like, you can just come here with all your friends and you can play. And it was just like, yeah, you know, it's kind of getting him thinking about the different areas that universities can be in. Like, it's not all just city focused and stuff.
Yeah.
So it's very like small things that we were doing with them,
yeah,
to kind of get them thinking about university.
That's really cool, because I like how you're able to relate it within their context. So that's pretty cool in regards to that. But then the question I have is that, how did you enter this world? Is it like, you know, did you just stumble upon an opponent or what?
So I went to a conference a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
When you had about five or six people up on a panel.
Yeah.
And the question that was posed was, how did you get into this profession?
Yeah.
And every single one of them said, I fell into it.
Okay.
And you really do just fall into it. There's nothing, you can't necessarily study to become a student recruitment officer or a wanting participation officer.
Mm.
I initially started off as a student ambassador. So I went to university,
mm-hmm,
St. Mary's University in Twickenham.
All right.
And I studied media arts.
Okay.
And I started working as an ambassador, and it was just kind of a job which was, you know, a couple of hours here, a couple of hours there. The more you did, the more, you know, the managers knew you, the more kind of work that you'd be given. Right. Even though if any of my ambassadors are listening, that's not how it works.
It's all a bit of brown envelopes going on here, yeah?
Yeah. But hey, I don't want to say it comes down to trust. If your managers can trust you, then they're going to be more comfortable giving you something. But no, it was, I mean, the proactive ones get the most work, I think. Mm-hmm. And that's what I was. I was very proactive. As soon as an email came out with loads of jobs, I'd look at my diary and kind of go, where can I work? Reply back straight away, like, I can work this. So I did a lot of work, and I knew the job that they did, but again, I didn't have that light bulb moment.
Yes.
And when I graduated, I still didn't have that light bulb moment, even though one of the managers said, oh, we might have a position coming up.
Mm.
Didn't think of it. And I went off, I enjoyed my summer, and I got an email from my boss saying, oh, can we have a quick chat? And I was just like, and it was, she was a great manager, mm-hmm. but she was one of those people, if you got one of those kind of, we need to talk emails.
Yeah.
My heart was racing. My heart was like, what did I do? Has there been a complaint? Like, what's going on? But she basically said to me, like, you know, we had these two jobs going, no one applied for it. We're surprised that you didn't apply for it. I thought, oh man. But she was like, oh, can you come help us over the summer? This is summer 2012. And I was like, yeah, I mean, I've just left uni, why not?
Yeah.
And so I'm doing like a couple of, you know, bits of admin, you know, helping on an open day, that kind of stuff. It was more of like the admin, you know, admin stuff that you don't see as a student.
Yep.
And my head of department, you know, she called me in one day and she kind of sat me down, spoke to me about the role. And she was like, oh, I think you should consider applying for it.
Mm.
And I was like, okay, you know, I'll have a think about it. And in my head, I'm thinking, yeah, man, I should. Yeah. This is a great opportunity for me to come straight out of uni. I've had my 2-3 months off.
Yep.
And I can get into it.
Correct.
So I applied, I got the job, and it was a 1-year contract. And I thought, this is perfect. In my head, obviously, I wanted to go into media. I wanted to go into radio production. That's what I wanted to do.
Mm.
And I saw this job paying me about 19K. As a 20, 21 year old, you're thinking, this is, why not? You know,
of course, mate.
I'm at the university that I studied at. I still got my friends are there. You know, it's going to be a vibe. So I go there. I'm there for a year, and I'm telling my manager, what are you going to do afterwards? And I said to him, well, I'm looking to, you know, I was looking to do a job for maybe a year, year and a half, and then think of something different.
Yeah.
So this perfectly fits into my career path.
Yep.
Anyway, we jump forward 6 months, the contract negotiations begin to extend my contract. And I'm like, okay, this still kind of works. Yeah. I get a little bit of a pay rise. I'm happy where I am. I'm enjoying what I'm doing, most importantly.
Mm.
You know, I'm going around the country, meeting new people. It's a fun time. But in the back of my mind, I kind of felt like I was like a footballer or something like that.
Yeah.
You know, am I going to get a contract? Am I not? They're debating. My head of department, I'm thinking like, my head of department is my agent right now. She's doing negotiations for me. And I remember I got a phone call saying, oh, you have to reapply for your job.
Okay.
Oh, come on. And HR hit me. Just it's like, you ain't no footballer. You have to do this our way. That's it. You know? So I ended up applying for the job again. And I got it as soon as within like a couple of hours of it closing, I was the only person who applied. So they gave me the job, and I think, oh, okay, now I'm actually full time. I don't have to worry about losing a job in the next couple of months. Yeah. I can relax a little bit more and get more into what I'm doing. And I did. Mm-hmm. It was really fun. I was going out to schools in like in Southeast London, like Lewisham, you know, these really rough schools, but nice kids. Absolutely, yeah. Nice kids. And that kind of brought my love for what I was doing and for what I am doing. So I ended up continuing more, and here I am, 7 and a bit years, 8 years after leaving uni, still doing the same job that I only wanted to stay in for a year and a half at the most.
Amazing, because I was actually going to touch upon that, because at first when I was looking at your LinkedIn profile, I'm thinking, let me guess, he had so much fun at uni, he decided, you know what, what's the point of leaving? Let me just stay here and work for a while. So, but now you've explained it better, I've understood why, and it is rare for, I mean, even look, your starting salary is what people don't get for the first 5 years of graduating. You know, you'd be lucky to get yourself a gig at some retail store. And so as a result of it, and it's also something you love to do. So people nowadays in a job for 20 years don't want to wake up in the morning for the jobs. You actually was enjoying it. So that's you know, makes a lot more sense. Because my next question was, you've been with them for 6-7 years. So that's really impressive, you know, with your current job. But then let me ask a question. If you were having so much fun, if you were enjoying it, it's your university, you can, you're like a case of, you know what, I'm not only the president, I'm also a client in regards to, you used to be a former student. Yeah.
Yeah.
What made you move on?
I mean, I think without going into the deeper things, but I think it got to a point where I wanted to do something different.
Okay.
I wanted a new challenge. Not that I wasn't being challenged, but after a while,
yeah,
you keep working with the same schools, you keep working with the same teachers, and it was nice seeing the progression of the students. You know, students I've been working with since they were in year nine, who are now starting the first year of university. That was nice. That was fulfilling, because you're like, actually, my words and everything that I said to them, they really did take that in.
Mm.
But at the same time, I thought if I stay, that may hinder my future work opportunities, where people may think, you know, you've been at this place for 15 years, and you're only deciding to move on now. So I thought, actually, I need a new challenge. I kind of need a break from the place that I studied. And I also we had staff football as well. And anyone who got up to the 10-year mark would get a testimonial. And I thought, I don't want a testimonial.
Wait, hold on. 1 minute, you're the football player negotiating your next contract. Next minute, you don't want to play the testimonial match.
Yeah, literally. I thought that the testimonial, I thought 10 years is a long time.
Yeah.
And if I was to channel my inner Zlatan, something that he would probably say is, Zlatan doesn't do testimonials. Like he said, didn't sign for Arsenal, and he was asked why he didn't go on a trial, and he says, Zlatan doesn't do trials. Yeah, the body doesn't do testimonials. No, but in all seriousness, I think it was just the right time to move, and I was thinking about moving for a while.
Yeah.
But one of the things that I know in myself that I don't do is I don't jump at any opportunity.
Correct.
I wait for that right opportunity that's right for me and something that I want to do.
Yep.
So it got to the point where I was somewhat kind of was not disenfranchised, but disconnected from, you know, the institution.
Yeah.
And I separated the history I had with the place and what was going on. Okay. And I thought, actually, you know, I enjoy what I'm doing, and that's what I'm focusing on. All this other politics that you get in workplaces, I'm just going to keep my head down, do what I love, and then seek an opportunity if and when it comes. And I had other colleagues who jumped at an opportunity straight away and like moved to other areas of the country because they wanted to move on. And that's not me. Like I said, you know, I waited. And there was an opportunity to leave at summer of 2017.
Yeah.
And I was, you know, I've had enough of, and I did get to that point where I was like, you know what, I've had enough of waiting for that opportunity. I just need to jump.
Yeah, yeah.
But I stayed because I had a really, a guy that I know who worked at another university, who worked at, I mean, he's back at King's now, King's College London. He worked in one participation, and he's amazing at what he does.
Mm-hmm.
And he was coming over to be my line manager. And I thought, you know what? I want to stay. I want to learn from this guy.
Yep.
And he will help me develop my career. And he did.
Nice.
I learned so much from him. And I said to him in the meeting, one of our first meetings, I said, look, I was thinking about leaving, but I'm staying because you're here.
Mm.
I know what you do and what you have done, and I think it'd be great to work with you. So I had that loyalty there. And then we went through kind of redundancy and severance era, which most companies will go through that period. And I thought, this is now my opportunity, right, if I can get it. If I can get it, that is. You know, mm-hmm. We had to apply for it and go through, you know, their process. And it was, even at that point, when I was talking to my line manager about it, and he said, look, like, you are an asset to this place. You know, mm-hmm. You've brought in students for many years. You've been recognized. I had an honorary life membership at the Students' Union for services to students, both past and present.
Oh, sweet.
Nice. You know, so my work was recognized. I was on, you know, familiar basis with the vice chancellor. He used to introduce me to all these dignitaries. And obviously it was a Catholic university, so we had loads of people from the Vatican and all this kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. But all these dignitaries that he brought in. And I remember one time there was kind of a load of like cardinals from the Vatican.
Oh yeah.
He introduced me to them, right? And we had a laugh and a joke. And I looked at, as I walked away, I looked at him and I went, oh, thank you. Like, I'll give you a fiver later on in front of all the dignitaries. You know, like, that's how comfortable I was at the place. You know, I could get away with, you know, saying those kind of, you know, funny remarks to, nice, to people in senior positions. I was very much a loved character,
yeah,
at the university.
Mm.
So I'm talking to my line manager, and he's saying that, you really got to think about your plan B,
right?
So, because I don't think that they're going to let you go. So you need to think about your other options, because now they're going to know that you want to leave.
Right.
And it was something that I didn't vocalize. But now this is, you know, HR are going to know, senior management are going to know when they go through all of these applications.
Yes.
That you want to leave.
Hmm.
And that was going through my head. I just got a pay rise as well. And then I submitted my application just after I got a pay rise. So the package would have included my new salary, not my old one. That's why the patient works. The patients work. Yeah. Just wait, get the pay rise, and then hand the application in. and everything kind of just fell into place. You know, my head of department called me in for a meeting one day, and he just said, yeah, your application's been accepted. How do you feel? And I was taken back by it, because I didn't think, I'm planning for plan B, yes, you know. Well, not plan A is just kind of, yeah, whatever, it's plan A.
Yeah.
You don't think that your application is going to be accepted for you to leave.
Correct.
So it was that kind of sudden realization, like, oh, I'm about to leave. But it was kind of a happy medium. Like, I left on good terms, essentially.
But hold up, one quick question. Even though you got the increased pay rise and the better package, wasn't there a little bit hit to the stomach that you are dispensable, that they were willing to let you go? Or were you just grateful that at least they let you go on good terms?
Yeah, I was grateful that they just let me go on good terms. Because I think at a time when, you know, people are making cuts.
Yeah.
You don't have to see yourself as indispensable. You just kind of have to think, at least I'm leaving on good terms, I'm not being
good point.
Hired.
Good
point. Yeah.
Nice.
So, you kind of have to get away from that and just think, actually, I'm probably doing it for the greater good. But there were definitely times after I accepted it all,
yeah,
that I thought I was making the wrong decision.
Of course, yeah.
Well, I thought, I was in my head, I'm thinking, have I made, you know, I'm leaving somewhere that I'm comfortable.
Yeah.
And I know the job and I love what I'm doing, and I'm going into that unknown.
Mm.
And that was quite scary. And then the flat that I was living at with friends, our landlord, on the same day that I accepted that severance package,
yeah,
the same day, the landlord that we're renting from told us that he's selling the his flat, and gosh, he's giving us a month's notice.
Oh my gosh!
And I'm thinking, my entire comfort that I had.
Yeah.
Within the space of 3 hours, gone. Everything. But It was definitely a blessing, alhamdulillah. I took 7 months off.
Nice.
7 months, you know, and the one thing that everyone was asking me,
yes,
was, what are you going to do afterwards? And my answer was straight up,
yeah,
I'm not planning for what I'm going to do afterwards. I'm going to enjoy what I have right now.
Yeah,
I've got the freedom. I've got the luxury to just relax. Nice. And I went over to the US. And that year in particular, in March 2018, April 2018,
yeah,
I spent more time in the US than I did in the UK that year.
Hold on. Was it that? Wait. When did Trump come into power? Was it?
Was 2017.
Damn, you were there during Trump, man, with your afro in full effect. Yeah.
2016. Yeah. I was there full effect. My afro was rocking. It was rocking. In the middle of- And yeah, so I was just traveling around, and I took all that time off and just relaxed. You know,
honestly, Mubarak, I don't blame you, because you deserve it. Because come on, usually people take a year out after university. You went straight into work. You grafted. You are working on crazy schedule, trying to convince people to actually, you know, go. So yeah, it's good. I'm happy you took a break. Yeah. And didn't, you know, launch a business or actually, but you just took your me time. So that's good, my friend. That's good.
Yeah, it was definitely me time that was needed. And that first Monday where I didn't have to set an alarm, yeah, I didn't have to set anything. Beautiful.
Nice. Well, okay. So I want to talk about, so you've taken a plunge, you took on a 7 months break. Yeah. But then what was the next step? I mean, I know I can see on LinkedIn where you are now, but how did that come about?
So I was in the US. It was my second stint of the summer.
Yeah.
You can only stay there for a certain period of time.
Yeah.
Before you have to go back.
Yeah.
So it was kind of nearing the second period, is about August time.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, okay, I've had enough, you know, I calculated, you know, I've got enough money to last me till the end of the year, comfortably.
Nice.
But I also haven't had an income for 4 months.
Mm.
You know? So reading it, I thought I needed to start thinking about the next steps, but not putting too much pressure on. And I saw this, the role that I'm currently at the University College of Osteopathy.
Mm-hmm.
And I applied for it because I was quite interested. It's a small university, small specialist university in London.
Yeah.
And that kind of intrigued me. I thought, okay, this will be quite a good challenge to see what this place is about. I applied for it, and they got back to me with an interview date. Alhamdulillah, it was after I landed into the UK.
Okay.
Before I would have had to do it. I had another interview for a university, and they scheduled it whilst I was in the US, and I thought, and I got them to change. They couldn't change the time, but they could change the method. And I was like, oh, I'm in the US.
Okay.
Thinking that's going to give them a hint, but maybe I should have told them, well, can you change it to later on in the afternoon UK time? So it's earlier for me, but that didn't happen. So I had to get up at about 3:30 for a 4 o'clock interview, 4 o'clock in the morning.
Wait,
so
hold up. Which university was it, and that did you had that interview, or you don't want to disclose it for your own reasons?
I'll keep him quiet.
Okay, I was gonna say, what kind of crazy ass time is that? You know what I'm saying?
And it's funny, like I see them, and I tell them, oh, they're like, oh yeah, you applied for that job, didn't you? I was like, yeah. I was like, I'm not surprised I didn't get it, because I was interviewing at 4 o'clock in the morning, you know, and that's another thing, like working in this job, like,
yeah,
you know, people at other universities, you see each other, you travel the country, you go to Europe and you do all these events. So we all know each other. We might be working at kind of rival universities at points,
yeah,
but we're all friends at the end of the day. We're all, nice, you know, we've got that same common goal.
Yeah.
So, you know, so when a student asks me, you know, oh, where can I do this course as well? I'm like, oh yeah, go and speak to so-and-so at this place and have a look at this uni, have a look at this uni.
Mm.
Yeah, so it's funny that you sometimes will be interviewed by people that you've been on, you know, on the circuit with for 3-4 years now. and you kind of rose up through the ranks together, and now here you are potentially about to work together. But going back to this job in particular, I had my interview the day after I landed back from the US.
Okay.
There's no rest for me. I went straight into it. And they asked me in the interview. The interview was quite a relaxed interview, I'd say. Yeah. Because they asked, how did you hear about us?
Yep.
And I just said, I'm going to be honest, I couldn't pronounce the word osteopathy.
I can't do that.
Yeah, like I couldn't. I couldn't pronounce it. And they started laughing. They're like, oh, that's fine. But, I tried. I was just honest with them. And they asked me, how did you hear about us? And I was like, I've driven past you. That's all I know. I don't really know what osteopathy is or what you guys do. But it was interesting. I managed to kind of get through and do well. And they called me back within a couple of hours.
Nice.
And said that I wanted to start. And here I was in some kind of... I was on cloud nine. I'm thinking I've just come back from the US, and within 24 hours, I got myself a job. That's a stat.
Yeah. The question I want to ask about when you got the job, you've come from St. Mary's University, which is, it's not a huge university compared to other universities in London and also around the UK. But I'm guessing the University College of Osteopathy, if I said that correctly.
Yeah.
Is that's also smaller than St. Mary's. So how was the change for you going from a large university to a smaller one?
It was interesting.
Okay.
To say the least. Good interesting, not bad interesting.
Mm.
St. Mary's in itself, it was small, but you knew everyone pretty much. Mm. There may be a few people that you didn't know, but you really, you kind of had an idea of where they worked, but you just didn't know their name.
Right.
But going to the UCO, it was much smaller. Most of the staff are on one floor. You have a few staff kind of dotted on some of the other floors, but again, you just knew everyone.
Right.
So there wasn't much difference there. The students as well, you recognize the students, you know the students. So it was really much like this kind of family community type atmosphere. I mean, there are still a few people, because we have a lot of osteopaths who may only work one or two days a week within our clinic, whether it's teaching or being a clinic tutor. I don't really see them as much because they're in another building, unless I'm physically over in that side of the building, getting treatment or showing people around, and I've bumped into them or spoken to them. But there are still a few people that I don't know at the university in itself. But it was vast. The numbers of students that we attract, how our open days are run. At St. Mary's, we had this huge kind of operation. We took up the entire tennis center. We'd deck it all out with marketing stuff, and we'll make the place look good. But here, when I organize the open days, again, we do marketing stuff, but it's on a much smaller scale.
Right.
I can set up here within an hour, hour and a half. I could have set everything up for my open day. At St. Mary's, it would take us maybe half a day or so to make sure everything is set and ready to go.
Mm.
But that's because, there's a huge, huge campus that we had. And UCO is just in, near London Bridge. And we've got the one building that we teach in and then the clinic building. So different operations. And it still gave me that same feel, which is why I chose the place as well. It gave me that feel of somewhere that really cared for students.
Right.
And looked out for students. And because, we may only have, 80 or so students coming in per year.
Right.
That if one student is falling behind, the tutors know who that person is and can give them that support that they may need. Nice. So you're not falling behind and everyone's, progressing together. So, it, I mean, yeah, it's it's different. There are obviously some obvious differences between the two. Obviously, focusing on one course was a blessing. Alhamdulillah for me, it was so good.
Yeah.
You know, knowing as, you know, because half of our job is you really got to know the course.
Mm.
You got to know all of your courses, entry requirements, some of the key facts, some of, you know, what you learn, all that kind of stuff, all that information that we need that we feel that will be useful to a student. And the industry secret, I don't know if I should give away the industry secret, is
I ain't stopping you. Go for it.
I mean, all I'm going to say is there are definitely some courses,
yeah,
that we blag.
All right.
There's a couple of two, because you learn the ones that you get asked about the most, your specialisms, the one that, you know, you know that you're going to attract students for.
Yeah.
And there may be a couple of courses in the background that do well, but you won't have streams of people coming to you. So at St. Mary's, the sports and teaching, I knew a lot.
Mm.
And here within the university now, osteopathy, once, you know, it's one course. I just got to know the ins and the outs, and that's it. And I can keep repeating that again and again. I'm almost like a broken record at some events. Just keep repeating what osteopathy is, what they do, and everything.
So. No, that's good. I mean, okay, now I want to come to the point of a career perspective, okay? So I know, like you said in the beginning, that when you had this conference a few years ago, you found a lot of your colleagues kind of fell into it. But let's imagine your boy here is hungry to become a student recruitment officer, okay?
Yeah.
And either, let's just imagine I've just graduated or I haven't even started university. What is the learning path or skills needed to enter this world?
So the skills, if you're graduating from university, essentially a knowledge of some degree.
Yep.
Because then you can really use that to your advantage when you're talking about content and timetables of different courses. Are you in 15 hours a week or 10 hours, whatever that might be? So you've got something to contrast it to. But definitely someone who's really good with people.
Mm.
A lot of the job is talking. You know, you can spend hours and hours and just talking to people.
Mm-hmm.
So you kind of have to enjoy it. I mean, there are definitely going to be days where you're not in the mood to talk as much, but because it's a service, it's a customer service, essentially.
Yeah,
you've got to give that same energy from the first person you speak to at the event at 9:30 to that last person that you speak to at 2:30 or 3 o'clock, depending on how long the event is.
Wow.
You know, you've got to be able to maintain that those energy levels.
Yeah, sorry.
It's lots kind of interpersonal empathy as well, talking about your own experiences. You know, like me, often when kids say, oh, I didn't get the right AS levels or something, I'm like, look, I just about scraped it into year 13. I've got the ability to kind of tell them, yeah, you know, you don't have to get the best grades to get to university. You know, there are different needs. So you're having that empathy.
Right.
Logistics as well. You've got to be able to think and just be a quick thinker. Because there are times, you know, if you're stuck on a train and, you know, you're traveling up to, say, Huddersfield or wherever, you know, a small town where you're just like, I'm stuck on a train.
Yeah.
I've got no signal. I need to get in contact with someone. Most people, some people in that kind of pressure situation will start to panic, but you've got to be able to kind of deal with that. Or you're at an event and none of your equipment has turned up.
Oh.
So usually at an event, we have a tablecloth where we've got like branded with our university logo on.
Yeah.
We'll have some pop-up banners that go up behind us. We have all of our kind of marketing material as well.
Okay.
Now, I would usually bring that, but sometimes there might be times where I just send it to one of our, like, a logistics company.
Of course.
And obviously things happen, things go wrong. No, nobody's perfect.
Right.
And you kind of have to think, what do I do now? You know, because there's nothing you can do in that situation. You've turned up at your booth, you've got nothing there. you speak to the event organizer and they go, we don't have anything in the back. And your panic levels are rising, but you really have to kind of start thinking, what can I do? There's certain things that you can do and there's things that you can't do. I think you just got to be level headed.
I was going to say,
you know, you learn, you know, from your first year of doing the job or your first few events, you learn what works for you. And then you kind of develop that in the next year, 2 years or so, to you've all of a sudden got this slick method that works for you.
Nice.
So it is one of those jobs that it's good to bring in loads of different skills.
Yep.
At the same time, you learn so quickly, you know, when you're stuck in areas. I had an interview for a global recruitment officer.
Yeah.
And one of the questions I was asked in an interview was, you're in Hong Kong.
Okay.
You've gone to an event and none of your materials have turned up. What do you do? I was panicked at that question. I don't know what I'll do then. You know, it's those kind of situations. It's just all about remaining calm. Like, that's the most important thing.
It's
not panicking and just kind of going through the different steps. You know, whether that is going to an internet cafe and printing off your prospectus, that's something that you may just have to do, you know?
Yeah. No, I mean, okay. So you mentioned someone who knows about degrees. So it would have to be a graduate to at least be a student recruitment officer, because you can't really sell university courses if you've never been to university. And also, like you mentioned, someone who's quick thinking and able to be level-headed. That's what you recommend as a skills and learning path-wise. But then you've touched upon it, but now what unique skill do you believe has helped you to become successful to the point where you're on chummy terms with the vice chancellor at your last role, and actually you are killing it as well crushing it in your current role? You know,
yeah.
This word, pun intended there. Yeah, but go ahead. Yeah. Sorry, I mean, go ahead, Mubarik.
It's my communication, I think. I've got a very unique way of communicating, very both formally and informally as well. When I go into schools, I don't stand there and think, yeah, I'm the teacher and I've got to do this and I've got to do that.
Yeah.
I go in. I mean, some of these kids I'm talking to are 16, 17, 18, even younger sometimes as well.
Yeah.
They have got brothers, sisters, cousins who are my age. You know, so I'm going to talk to them in a way that I'm not going to kind of tell them, oh, you have to do this and you have to that. I'm just going to talk to them on a real, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm not going to shy away from the questions that they ask me. I'm not going to stick to a plan. That's the most, I remember having a conversation with my first line manager, and he asked me to write down a kind of a session plan, a workshop plan. And I turned around to him and I said, I can write it down, but this isn't the way that I would go about it. I want to go with the flow and the vibe that the students are giving me. You know, so I try and make things fun. And I think that's what stands out to a lot of students and teachers, seeing these kids that they see as, you know, a difficult class. And I've had that before from teachers. Oh, this is a difficult class and I'm going to bring it on. You know, I they're the sort of kids that I want, because I know that they want to learn.
Yep.
And maybe the issue is you haven't given them that opportunity and that respect.
Correct.
And then you can vibe. You know, I try and respect the students. I try and, you know, divvy out the ones that are the so-called, like, the class clown, the practical joker, or the dominant energy within the room.
Yep.
And I'm gonna be this person's friend. Like, this is the person that I need to win over, and then the class are gonna. And sometimes I throw jokes out there. I stick it back on the kids when they try and do something funny, and I hit it back on them. You know, and it's just kind of creating that energy and that atmosphere. And I think that works from good communication. The communication is very key for me. And even ambassadors who work for me, the ones who've got great communication skills, I love, and I'm like, you guys are going to do brilliant in this kind of work. The ones who may not have those skills, it's fine. Like, I've seen students come in and work for me, and they've been shy, they've been timid.
Yeah.
2-3 years down the line, they are talking like normal. You know, they're not shying away from going into a big class of kids and talking to them about their degree.
Yep.
You know, so for me, definitely communication is one that has helped me communicating with all walks of life. I had a friend of mine now, and she was a mature student, and she came to study abroad. Mm-hmm. At St. Mary's, and she worked within, she interned within our department, and she was telling my wife that she the first time she met me in the office, and this is exactly what she said. She lives out in Seattle, and she made me laugh. She's like, the first time I met him, I saw this guy who's kind of doing his work. He was laughing and joking, and I thought, what's this guy doing? You know, like, he's either up making coffee in a particular way, or he's talking to lecturers and academics and this, like, what does he do? And she said, I went to one of his workshops, and my God, did I see a completely different side to him? Like, just so efficient, professional, and engaging, that she was like, I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe this is the same guy that I met 2 weeks ago. And he spent 15 minutes making coffee. I mean, it was great coffee that I made. Don't get me wrong. You know, and she's just like, he just does things like in a completely different way, which is just so amazing. And that hit me. I just thought, like, thank you. Like, you know, that means a lot to me. If someone sees this side of me, yeah, and then comes to one of my workshops and see how I mix the two together. You know, I drop the laughy, jokey side to an extent, bring that into a professional setting where I'm talking about personal statements. I mean, if you're going to make a group of year 12 students laugh, yeah, in a personal statement or a student finance talk,
yeah,
you know, that's a skill. That's a skill to have.
Oh, no, I understand, Mubarik. Definitely, you're spot on. Skill is a very important one to have, especially if you're making 12-year-old. Year 12 laughs. I mean, I was gonna blame it all on the afro, saying the afros would kind of bonds people to you, but no, you're right. For you to be able to communicate a message formally and informally is an impressive task. However, I want to still stay on the topic of skill, and if I was a genie, or I had the ability to grant you superpower, what superpower would you like to have? That's right.
What superpower would I want to have?
Yeah. And bear in mind, I've, in the context of skills, okay? I don't want some, you know, you know what? I'll let you go wild with it. Yeah, go for it. What kind of superpower would you have?
Yeah. I was like, you're trying to put me in a box and say, this is the only something you can do.
Yeah, you're for real already. But I'm like, you know what? Just in case my man comes up with some weird flex, but no, go for it.
Do you know what I was going to say? The ability to grant any wish that I want.
Oh, look, I knew it.
Hey, look, there's one thing that people who know me will know about me for sure, is I love a loophole. If there is any loophole, I'm taking that loophole and I'm running a mile with it. Like, my old workplace, salad bowl.
Yeah.
When you buy a lunch, when you buy a salad bowl, you have a small bowl, medium, yeah, and a large.
Okay.
Right? Yeah. And there was a price difference.
Uh-huh.
And I got, you know, and we used to fill up the salad bowl, the yeah, small one.
Yeah.
And we used to go through the till, and that was fine. Yeah. You know, no one ran the line, except for this one kid. This one guy just one day. He kind of went to him thinking, yeah, like, I know him. He's going to be cool, like, whatever.
Yeah.
And I made this salad bowl, like, it looked like the Leaning Tower of salad. Well, I filled it up. I'm getting my money's worth, right? and he stopped me, and he goes, oh, come on, man. Like, you know, that's you're just taking the mick there.
Oh, my God.
Too much salad. You know, I'm going to have to charge you for two.
No.
And I was like, hold on a minute. And I was like, are you... am I charged for the contents or the bowl, the pot that I put the food in?
Yep.
And he's like, the pot, but, and I was like, no, there's no buts. There's no sign over there that says the pot must close.
Oh, you know, nice, the loophole.
As a, so until then, I can fill it up.
Honestly, mate, you know what? Okay, all right, respect. I give you that. Like, your superpower is the ability to grant as many.
Yeah. Like, I'm taking a loophole. Like, you thought that you're going to put, me, who's read it, it's the last time that Ibrahimovic's autobiography is, down to a tweet. So you're going to put me in a box. I'm jumping out.
All right, okay. No problem. I'll give you that, mate. I'll give you that. I'm going to now flip the script, ask you a few more awkward questions this time. All right?
Here we go.
So, I was not going to let this opportunity pass. So let me take you back, okay? Back in the days, a little trip down memory lane when university used to be free, okay? So 1998, yeah, tuition fees were introduced. But back then it was only £1,000, okay? Then in 2004, it went to £3,000.
Cool. I'm on the rope.
Yo, kept on rising until hit the magical number of 9,000. I think it's 9,200, which is the Mexican charge. Yeah,
9,250. Yeah.
Oh, okay. So, okay.
Come on, £50 means a lot.
Oh no, definitely. I'm already upset that there's actually a fee, but hey, no problem. So, honestly, do you think that it is fair students should be burdened with such a large debt before they even join the workforce?
You hit me with that 1-2.
Oh, definitely, mate.
Yeah, it's a 1, and now it's a 3, now it's a 9, and I was like, oh, maybe more. Did you watch Ali last night or something before?
When I had the opportunity for you to come onto my show, yeah. I'm like, there's no way I'm going to let the man slide. I had to drop this question,
Yeah. Like, it's those numbers, when you add them up, it's a lot of money. It's a scary number, when you're paying 9,250,
yeah,
and you're like, I have to do it over 3 years, it's nearly £30,000 just for tuition.
Yes.
It's a big burden to have, especially at 18, being told that you're going to be in this much of debt after 3 years.
Correct.
But the question for me is always, is it worth going?
All right.
And obviously, if I was to give the best advice and guidance, I'd say, is it worth for you to go to university? If you're looking at doing a career that doesn't need a degree, then so be it.
Mm.
But if it's something that you are really interested in,
okay,
yeah, and you want to become an expert in that field and you want to be able to hold your own in certain conversations,
yep,
that you may have, and you want to broaden that knowledge, you definitely go to university, but do something whilst you're at university.
Okay.
I feel like students have to get their money's worth, and if they're not getting their money's worth, then complain. Go through everything that you need to do to hold universities accountable. If you think, a tutor doesn't teach well enough, then make a point about it,
Right.
You're paying that amount. You're a consumer, essentially. You're a customer.
Correct.
And you can shop about. And there's something now which is called the TEF.
Okay.
Which is Teaching Excellence Framework. And universities are given either gold, silver, or bronze based on their levels of teaching.
Yep.
So, and that changed the whole dynamic of universities. You had these Russell Group universities who were getting bronze.
Wow.
You had some that were getting silver, and everyone thinking, they should be getting gold,
Definitely.
They're some of the best research universities in the country, which a lot of people who don't work with Russell Group institutions have some issues when students ask them that they want to go to. They ask us, are you a Russell Group university? And we throw the question back, do you know what a Russell Group university is?
Nice. Some of them
can't answer that question. So again, you know, they just hear the name, which is fine. You know, that's absolutely fine. But that's, you know, it's all about that right information. But that what the TEF did is, you know, elevate some universities that were kind of seen as, oh, you know, it's so and so university, but their teaching is fantastic. They've got gold level, you know, so that kind of made students think a little bit more about where they studied, what's right. The teaching standards like. And that's the most important thing for me, and it's holding places accountable.
Right.
If you don't like your lecturer, speak up about it. If you don't like something at the university, speak up about it. I've had conversations with my siblings who went to different universities, and it's that same old thing. They're like, oh, it shouldn't be charged, you know, $9,250. But I was like, have you complained about the things that you don't like?
Right.
You know, it's speaking up about what you feel isn't fair for your university studies. And then at the same time, when you're working,
yeah,
when you get that job and you start working, you start repaying, you pay back what 9% of your earnings over the threshold. And I think the threshold at the moment is roughly about 25,000.
Okay.
Just over 25,500 pounds. So, and the average salary is less than that for a graduate, I believe. So sometimes you may not be paying until you go over. And let's say someone's, you know, paying, someone's earning 26,000.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You pay 9% on whatever that difference is. So you may only end up paying £30 a month, £20 a month back from your salary.
Okay.
So it's very much affordable and manageable. And the question I always get back from students is, oh, but how comes, you know, I have to pay that back? And I was like, well, how comes you want the new iPhone or you want the new Samsung? Yeah. And you're happy to pay £70-80 a month for this contract so you can have this brand new phone, but then you're complaining about having to pay back £20 a month or £25 a month for your education.
It's a good point, and I do agree with you in the sense of, like, since now the student is a customer, you know, you need to hold university accountable. And definitely, if you want value for your money, you know, make sure you all the services being provided is actually provided to your standard. But look, I want to still kind of focus on the tuition fees, because I like to compare the UK to the US, and especially you've been out there, so you know how the US is. But I'm sure you already know, but the US charge high tuition fees, and I think the UK is kind of falling down that path. But when I last checked, the student loan debt was $1.6 trillion. Okay, now that makes it the second highest consumer debt category, only behind the mortgage debt. Okay, now I don't know about the UK, but for the US, what is scary is that unlike mortgage or credit card debt, student loans cannot be discharged in bankruptcy. So these guys will always have this debt hanging over their head. Okay.
Yeah.
So do you think the UK is slowly gravitating towards this, or do you think for the UK is only slightly different? They've just increased in order to help universities, or are we just falling down the rabbit hole with good old US?
No, I don't think we're falling down the rabbit hole with the US. Yeah, the US, that system where, you know, you're paying back $400-$500 per month.
Wow.
You know, and there's a lot of times where you get scholarships and all this other stuff to help, but it's still quite expensive.
Mm.
Why they do where they give you discounts if you stay within your state. So if you go to a college within your state, you get a discount.
Okay.
Which is quite interesting, but again, you know, their whole thing is much more of a competition.
Okay.
But we won't be. I mean, if you're earning 30 grand a year,
yeah,
and you lose your job, your repayments stop. It's linked to your income. If your income, you know, subsides, so if you go under that 25,000 or, you know, 25 something, I think it's 25,750, I believe.
Right.
If you go below that, your repayments stop.
Right.
You know, so it's just that threshold that they're looking for. You know, we all go through different things where we want, you know, we want a career change. We want to, you know, work part-time in a coffee shop. I mean, I'm saying that because, I mean, that'd be ideal for me to own my own coffee shop one day, inshallah. Who knows?
Oh, nice, mate. No, I'll be your first customer because I do love coffee, man. Yeah, go for it. Yeah.
And obviously, when you're doing that, you know, your income may drop considerably, especially if you've been in this high-flying city job. You know, that us Londoners, sometimes, you know, we kind of get, we don't see that privilege of working within London and what getting London living wage and all that kind of stuff.
True.
You know, you just stop all of a sudden, you're working part-time, your income's dropped, your repayments will drop. It's going to be comparative to what you earn.
Yeah.
The more you earn, the more you pay back. The less you earn, the less you pay back. And then after 30 years, it's gone.
Oh, wow.
Which is what we have, which is why a lot of US people try and pay that off as quickly as possible, because they've got crazy interest that goes on. Whereas our interest levels are comparable, and they're very low. So,
okay, that kind of comforts me, to be honest, because I was thinking we just fall in the US and it's going to eventually implode with this whole I mean, now even I mean, look at it. I just was reading just before we did our recording today, I was reading that Harvard actually said they're going to still charge the $50,000 a year, even though it's all going to be online for next year, you know, for the 2021. Yeah. And so that would kind of shocked me. I'm thinking to myself, but I know I agree with you, and it's good to know we do have much more rights. But okay, let's move away from the US. I want to bring it closer to home.
Yeah,
I want to compare the UK tuition fees to our closest neighbors. I would have said France, but I chose Germany because I know Germany university is free.
Yeah.
Okay. So even though the UK will be leaving the EU in the near future, which I'm going to, you know, touch base with you with that a bit later on, what would stop a UK student from simply hopping over, when I say overseas, over to Europe and getting a degree? Why do we need to have a UK university?
I mean, it goes back to that age old thing where I think I've said it before. Do what you feel is best for you.
Yeah. Correct.
If you see another opportunity where university will be free for you, or it's cheaper, or whatever you want, you know, do it. But you've also got to do some more research as well.
Yeah.
I mean, if you're a German speaker, that's fantastic. But if the university is only teaching in German and you've got no German background, or you don't have to speak German, it may not be the right decision for you. So, you know, if it's an English-speaking university and they teach in English and in German, then obviously you can pick up German and go from there.
Yeah.
But I mean, for me personally, if I see a student who says, I'm going to go to Germany and study and do the course, I found a university that teaches in English and that, go do it. You've done your research, which I'm happy about. Most students tend not to do research sometimes, at their chosen place. And you know what's right for you. I spoke to a student, actually, I went back into my old school a few times to do kind of their UCAS day talks.
Okay.
And I was walking around Ealing, and this guy said hello to me, this kid. And I was like, hi, you know, I'm a nice person. You know, I'm approachable.
Yeah.
And he was like, oh, you came into my school. And I'm like, oh, what school was that? And he mentioned it. I was like, oh yeah, like I know the school, cause I only go in there once a year.
Yeah.
And the cohort is quite small. So I recognized him. I did.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, so what are you doing now? And he's like, oh, I'm waiting. I've taken a gap year. I was like, nice. What are you doing?
Yeah.
He's like, I'm working in a hospital, just kind of here, thereabouts. So I want to do medicine at uni. And I was like, okay, cool. Like, you're doing medicine. Not many ethnic minorities go into, from our background, go into, Somali background, go into that field as much that I see with my own eyes. I don't want people to kind of come back and be like, I'm Somali and I do medicine. Yeah. Like from the students that I've spoken to.
Yeah.
And he's like, he's going to go do it in Hungary.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Because it's cheaper. And my first question to him was, is it accredited? Is it one of those you can come back and he's like, yeah, it is.
Okay, good.
So like, go do it. If it's cheaper for you, it's quicker, go do it.
Interesting.
Like, I don't have a qualm. Like, some other people may disagree, but for me, I'm like, look, you're going to uni. Yes. You're doing something you enjoy. Go do it. I'm not going to say you've made the wrong decision by going to Hungary. I see one question. Is it accredited?
Yep.
That's good. It. The same with teachers who learn to be primary school teachers or whatever. I'm like, if you're going to go off to Dubai or Qatar or wherever,
yeah,
you'll teach, finish your NQT year here.
Yes.
And then go over. Because you don't want to spend 10 years teaching over there, come back, and then you're told, oh, you haven't done your NQT yet, so you have to do it.
Good advice, you know? Mate. Good advice.
So it's finish off the year and then go over. You know, and that comes with doing the research. So, you know, going to Europe, again, you're living in Germany.
Yeah.
You know, you've got like some of the best roads in Germany. So
don't get me started on that. Yeah, I drive an autobahn. I 100% agree with you.
Exactly. You know, like, and you're traveling as well. You know, you can go to Switzerland, you go France, all these places really easily. So just, I'd say do it.
Okay. Well, next question I have for you is regarding, and I'm sorry, I'm kind of bombarding all these kind of heavy conflicts. I'll try and keep it short and sweet. All right. And next one is about, and I touched upon it briefly, about when Harvard was still going to charge the full price. So in the UK, there was a petition that was launched where students, well, I'm not even going to mention about the whole accommodation and all that kind of stuff. They did a petition which collected over 347,000 signature, and they got a response from the government, which is kind of simply said, oh, check with your university, something along those lines. But they simply said they're not happy with the treatment because of COVID has forced all of them to conduct lessons online, and they want their tuition fees to be reimbursed. Now, what's your opinion on this matter? I know you can't speak on behalf of all university, but it'll be good to have a perspective of a guy who's telling, you know, people to come join university. Do you think it's fair university should still charge for this year, albeit since, okay, I'm going to add another twist. I mean, I've read some people on Twitter saying, oh my gosh, there's teacher strikes and now we got COVID. What's going on? I didn't study for a whole year. So what's your opinion on this, Mubarik?
do you know what? Like, I see the point. Yeah. I see the point because, you know, you're paying, you know, money to get a... I would hope that institutions are delivering as much information as they can and supporting students as much as they can.
Right.
And I think it's the support mechanism because it was hard. I mean, from, you know, speaking from a university's perspective, it was hard having to suddenly shut everything down and then work online.
Yep. So
and it's a transition.
Yep.
And whether some people got it right or wrong, I don't know. But yeah, I mean, if I was a student, I'd be like, why am I paying this amount of money to sit online and have online classes?
Correct.
But I think universities just need to be doing more around this period. It's actually having more support and putting things on for students to do, you know. And I think it's that it's such a difficult thing. It's so, because we don't know how long this whole situation is going to go on for, whether we get a second wave. It looks like it after the weekend in Soho. You're seeing pictures of people in Soho. I don't know, there's bound to be something that comes up. But yeah, I think it's, in my opinion, I think we just need to be doing more. I think it's hard to reimburse because then that puts the university in a position where potentially you know, people may have to start losing their jobs for the university to save, you know. So if we reimburse, you know, 9,250 or whatever the percentage may be, you reimburse that back, and that adds up, and that affects the teaching quality, and
correct,
and then essentially you kind of enter this kind of cyclical, you know, cycle of, you know, this lecturer has been let go, and this person's been let go, and this person's been let go, and then that affects learning, and So I think we just, as I said, I mean, it's, we just need to do more, put on more, whether that's, you know, hosting webinars and actually making people's time worthwhile, rather than, and one of the things that I have learned during this lockdown is don't try and replicate whatever you would do in person online, because it won't work. You need to have a different delivery method. You need to have other things that will still give people that experience.
Mm.
You know, it's bringing in, you know, speakers, bringing in people who work within the profession to give that, you know, advice on a certain topic or talk about a certain topic. I think if students had, you know, figures of that profession coming in,
it would
change. You know, if we had you coming in to talk about SAP or Nomad Consulting, you know, what you do.
Yep. Hey, I'm never going to say no to that. Yeah, you make sure you let people know. Yeah.
Exactly. I think it's small things, but I definitely do agree, you know, students should feel hard done by. No. But at the same time, it's such a crazy balance, because none of this was expected.
Correct. No, so true.
And there's always going to be an asterisk around that year.
Yeah.
And whether that's universities who are much more lenient when it comes to marking.
Yep.
And understanding that not everyone is going to, you may see some people who, you know, constantly get 80% or above, they may not do as well.
Correct.
And being mindful to that situation.
Fair.
And not marking students too harshly. If you think, you know, I know one of the things that we were looking at that I overheard was dealing with certain year groups who are more important. For us, we had our fourth year students who are finishing and going into the profession of osteopathy.
Mm.
Some of whom may not have reached, you know, their clinical hours that they needed and so on and so forth.
Correct.
So they really did take priority. It's like, what can we do for these fourth year students to ensure that they qualify with the right number of hours and, you know, get the same learning in that final few months as the previous years did.
Mm.
And whether that meant, you know, moving some assessments for some of the first year so that the tutors can really focus on fourth years. I think it's just rehashing what you do and understanding the needs, who needs the most help at this moment in time, probably your graduating students. They've got their dissertations to hand in. They've got their tutors who are working from home, and they can't have that communication, you know, where you could just walk into your tutor's office and have a conversation with him or her. You have to do it online. You have to schedule in a time to do all of that. But power to the students. I mean, if you want to complain about something, do it, and it will make the university realize that they need to do more.
No, it's good advice, and I do appreciate it. And I'm gonna drop one last heavy question for you, Mubarik, because it's a bit unfair. I'm actually throwing as much higher education for political question at you.
I expected it. I think the amount of times that I've been bombarded, I was bombarded by this year 9 student.
Yeah.
And we were talking about finance.
Yeah.
And she put her hand up and went, why do we have to pay so much for university?
Mm-hmm.
I kind of go, you know, the government cut funding and university have to subsidize and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And then she threw another question at me, and it was like a barrage of questions. You know, when teams are like under the cosh in a football game,
yes,
and you're hoping that your team hold on for those final 2-3 minutes, just like, just hold on. That's what I was thinking. I'm getting berated by this year 9 student. But do you know what? Like it's fine, because I usually have the answers for most things. The art of
to say, you can't be quoting our boy Trump there. I'm telling you right now.
No. Look, all I know is I'm going through a visa process, so the less I say, my life.
All right, okay, then I'll make you quiet for that. Okay, here's a nice political from a EU and UK perspective, okay?
All right.
So here we go. Besides COVID, you know we're dealing with the impact of Brexit, okay? Now, you tell me, is this a blessing or a curse for the university? Bear in mind that EU students constitute a major part of your customers.
Right now, it's definitely a curse.
Okay.
I mean, since when was the referendum vote? June 29th?
I lost count, mate. I mean,
something like that, 2016.
No, 2016, when we did the vote. And since then, we've been faffing about. We've been discussing. Right.
Since that day.
Yeah.
It's been an interesting situation. It's the amount of EU students who've emailed or called in to talk about Brexit and what's going on and how it's going to affect them. And each year it was funding is fine. Your tuition fees will stay the same.
Yeah.
But we don't know what's going to happen past X date. And that day kept on going back until quite recently. It was released that EU students will be paying the same amount as international students.
Wow.
Even earlier on this year, with that uncertainty, as soon as we, I'm pretty sure numbers, I haven't seen the numbers of EU students, but I'm pretty sure it's going to be lower than
crazy.
So it's been a curse in that sense because, London is, and the UK in particular, the UK is huge for EU students.
Yeah.
They love coming here. They love coming to study here. And it's always nice having EU students around. It's a different culture, different atmosphere.
Yeah.
It's completely different. And we have good relationships with institutions. There's, there's the Erasmus program.
Yep.
Where, staff, and if you're a student, you can go and study abroad for a year.
Yep.
In Spain, Germany, wherever. If you're a staff member, you can go over and work in your department, but over in another country, you can shadow, you can learn all about that. So those options were there. I'm not sure how that's going to work now going forward. But it's also opened the door for international students. Okay. It's opened the door for markets like China, India, the US. It'll probably bring in other areas of the world as well as viable markets. Because, EU students or international students do pay, £11,000-£12,000 a year, which in some cases may be cheaper than what they would pay at home. And they get an entirely different experience and a different level of education. And UK education has always been ranked pretty highly within higher education institutions for higher education around the world.
Mm-hmm.
We're still not touching some countries. I mean, the US have got ridiculously good universities.
Right.
It depends how you see it, but places that we things that we specialize in have been pretty good. So it'll be interesting to see what happens. And obviously, like anything, there's going to be a dip for a year or two, and whatever negotiation deals come up after this period of COVID, or what did one of your guests say the other week? Was it Sharona?
Sharona Maris Photon.
Yeah,
a boy came and said that. Yeah,
yeah. I've listened to a few of these. The Sharona Maris. So shout out. there's also going to be a dip, and once all this is done, then we probably get back onto the negotiating table. But it definitely was a sad day when we voted to leave, and also definitely a sad day within universities when we found out that funding was going to change for students.
I'll be honest, and I'm sure if I was to interview in a year's time, the things might change, because as the official date is December. But look, I've kept you really long enough, and in regards to the interview, time-wise. But look, I want to ask you two quick now, easy one, okay? Number one, if you had not become a student recruitment officer, what profession would you have found yourself? I mean, I know I got a slight hint when you mentioned about coffee, but go ahead.
I mean, it changes. Like, I've got a few things that I'm interested in, but...
Mm-hmm.
I think anything that would allow me to travel. I mean, maybe a pilot.
Oh wow!
Maybe some kind of not a coffee enthusiast. I think that's that will take up a lot of time, and I also want to travel. I mean, coffee can make you travel.
That's for sure.
But I quite like the idea of being forward facing, like front facing.
Okay.
So, forward, definitely something like. It's weird, like, you know, some people kind of think about this job that's just like, this is an amazing job, but never really think about what they would like themselves. It's right. Just like, I want to be, you know, I want to earn loads of money, but you know, I wouldn't mind working on running my own hotel, you know.
Oh,
that, like, for real, like, I think you can, your customer relations and you know, making sure that your customers are happy,
yeah,
and having that repeat customer. Come in and again and again and again, and I think I quite like that. Like, as I said, like, I'm quite a personable person.
Oh no, you are definitely, and I think, you know, even if you decided to open up a coffee shop, and from that perspective, hospitality area,
hospitality and traveling. If I can just travel the world, I love traveling. So if I could do that, then that would be great.
I like it. Okay, last question, because you dropped my boy's Latin name a few times. No, I had to ask. Yeah, so I support a legend of a team which Zlatan used to play for. So what football team do you support? Because a lot of football analogies going on here in this interview, so I need to ask, what team do you support, mate?
What team do I support?
Yeah, that's right. So what football team do you support? I mean, I'm guessing, since you mentioned Zlatan, are you a Man United fan like myself, or
no? Listen, I'm just a Zlatan fan. That's it.
All right, okay. You're gonna keep it on the down low in case you people don't know who you support then?
No, I follow my boy. I follow my boy Zlatan. You know, he's wherever he goes, I go. Apart from Man United, wherever he goes,
I was like that now.
Like, listen, Man United. But the one thing I love that Man United did for Zlatan's career,
yeah,
was it was a medical team.
Yeah.
Because obviously people were saying, you know, he was 34, 35 when he joined.
Yeah.
And they were like, you know, can he do it? Like, he's getting old. He's this, he's that.
Yeah.
But then they're like, the guy's got the same fitness as a 23-year-old reserve player.
Oh, my gosh.
See, like, everyone who doubted Zlatan.
Yeah.
Like, now I'm seeing loads of people jump on the bandwagon of Zlatan. I'm like, listen.
Yeah. He's a legend.
He's the man himself. But do you know what, like, since I've been going over to the US and stuff a lot,
yeah,
I've really got into US sports as well.
All right.
I think there's just a whole different kind of caliber of sports over there in comparison to what we have. Like, I mean, we've got football, and then yeah, if you want to spend a couple of hours watching tennis, that's great. Cricket, how's that? You know, the only time I played cricket was in school, and that was it. And that was only because they needed extra people. I was just like, all right. But yeah, no, I think it's like, I think like football in particular is probably my main sport, but is like, with the money that flies around, it's kind of a little bit disheartening, you know. I listen to Roy Keane, and Roy Keane makes me laugh.
Legend.
Whenever, I think it was the Man United Liverpool game, was it this season? And all the players are in the tunnel, and he's annoyed. Yeah. He's angry. He's just like, what's with all the hugging and kissing? He's like, you have to go to battle. Like, leave. Like, if you want to talk to them, talk to them at the end of the game. Don't talk to them in the tunnel. Which is true. Like, I think, but you know, each to their own. I think that style of football has brought in differences.
Correct.
And I see both sides. I love the pre-tunnel fights, but then at the same time, I'm like, yo, you know, if you're a Spanish speaker, if you're a Dutch speaker, whatever, you know, you got to show love to your boy. Yeah. You know, you don't have to show love to them in the pitch. And I think was it Rooney and Ronaldo?
Yeah.
Got into a scuffle in Euro 2004.
Yeah.
You know.
Yes, I know. I know.
You know, you, at the end of the day, like, you got to kiss and make up, you know. At the end of the day.
No, you're right, mate. You've mentioned some other legends in your football analogies there, with Keane, Ronaldo, and all that. But no, for me, Mubarik, you've been a gentleman and a scholar in regard to this podcast. You've given me some really good insight in the world of education, higher education especially. But, you know, I want to thank you for your time. But before I sign off, is there anything else you would like to add or mention that I've not covered?
That's always a good question at the end of a...
Because if we've really covered the high and low, which is why, and I just want to make sure in case I missed out something that, which you know, that you want to spread the love in that sense.
Spread the love. I mean, I'll spread the love to. I mean, I got to shout out the. I don't know what I'm going to say.
Yeah, this ain't no radio shout out.
I got to shout out my. My other half. Gonna give her a little shout out.
Sweet. Well, yeah, technically, I would call her your better half, mate. Alright. So, but that's because us guys. Let's just say, bro, I've been told a long time ago they're always our better half. So yes.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Well, that's true. That always is the case. You know what's that saying behind? Behind every strong man, there's an even stronger woman.
Oh,
is that the phrase? I can't remember what
no, exactly. Mate, I have some other funny jokes in my head. I ain't gonna say it out loud, but yes, you're right. Behind every great man is a great woman. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's it. No, hey, at least I said women are strong. That's yes. Thought I was gonna get some backlash. No, you know, I think yeah, that's true. But there's any guy, any listeners out there. Especially the men who think no, I'm gonna be the strong one in my nah, that's not the case, my friend. Like your better half will always have the final say.
No, for real, happy wife, happy life. I always say, mate. Yeah, you know what I'm saying, G.
That's the truth. I think there's way too many, especially the younger generation who think you know they're You need to rethink that the comments that you're making on Twitter and all this kind of stuff.
For real. No, you're right. And it always come back to haunt them. But no, I honestly, once again, thanks a million for this. I will give you a shout out on my social media as well as link you if you don't mind when I release this podcast.
Yeah, cool.
And I just want to say thanks again for your time. And basically, I will speak to you soon, my friend.
Yeah, speak to you soon, inshallah.
Hi, inshallah, man. You take care, man. Peace and
love. You too. Peace and love.
All right. Bye-bye. Well, that's all, folks. Thank you for listening to my podcast, which is simply the reflections of a nomad consultant living life on a day-by-day basis. I just want to conclude by saying I appreciate the love and support you guys are showing me. Until the next time, peace and love.